us. Hopefully you're here also to drink, which is good, good stuff. You're here to do some network, you're here to invest, you're here to check onto possibilities and investments that we're going to discover tonight. Should you need Wi-Fi, this is the access for station guests. Okay, the password is there for you guys to plug in and to see onto the platform the products that we're going to speak about tonight. Spreads, let me tell you what we do. Actually, we're really passionate about entrepreneurship. So basically, we were entrepreneurs ourselves. So basically, we created that platform to allow any investor to plug in into any product that makes sense in terms of investment. So really, our aim is to help investors to mitigate their investments and discover like early stage companies in which they would invest. Bear with me, is that early stage investment is risky. Okay, so we've got different products that we're going to speak about, or not products actually, and more services that we're going to speak about, in order to allow you guys to really start diversifying your investments. And we're going to speak about that later and how we do this. So basically, we've created an easy and secure fundraising platform, which is fully certified actually by the FSMA, so it's fully regulated. We don't speak about donation, okay? Donation, it's like platforms where people do give more or less 20, 30, 40 euros, not much. Rewards, it's like basically you just give money to and you get like a special present on special commercial conditions. Basically, we don't deal with that through spreads. We only deal with lending and equity. Whereas we believe that people putting money into the entrepreneur project will probably create also collective intelligence, where you put 1,000, 10,000, 100,000 euros, basically you're going to make sure that together with the entrepreneurs, you're going to try and raise more than just putting money. You're going to bring your knowledge, your know-how, just to make sure that this project will probably like boost. So this is what we do. We've got also, since we're talking about money here, we do have selection criteria. Different platforms, we're not going to name them, they do like a great job. Basically, you'll find also many projects, but they're going to be just dropped into that, into their system. You're not going to be able to really get like a decent feeling of what they do, what their vision is, the business plan. Whereas here at Spreads, we just make sure that certain criteria are being fulfilled. Basically, what we do here is that we really a crowdfunding platform. So we start at 100 euros, so it's really little. But you guys are investors. You always will be able to invest together with a co-institution, a co-investor, which is a lead investor, which is basically a person, a group, an institution, which will take the major risk or the major burden of the investment. Once again, we're going to talk about pre-select investments. So here, the four entrepreneurs that you're going to discover tonight, they went through different meetings, different committees, just to make sure that their project is fit and proper to be crowdfundable. We are also a European crowdfunding platform. So onto the platform, you're going to be able to see like projects coming from all over Europe. So you're going to see a French product tonight also. I leave you to discover all that. Basically, so far, we funded 98 companies and more. We've got 40,000 members, and so far, we invested 47 million, nearly 48 at this stage, to give you a glimpse about what we do. So here we talk about something, it's how we've been structured as a legal platform. So basically Spreads, all the structure which is Spreads Finance, and you guys are investors, you will invest into what we call a compartment. It's the compartment which will actually broadcast the share and take, I mean, the participation into the company. And then as a platform, we just broadcast what we call equity link notes for the crowd. Few advantages is that for the entrepreneur, he is like only faced with one legal representative. Okay, he's only faced with one person, whereas in different platforms, if you've got many investors, you're faced with many stakeholders. Here, we do all the communication for the entrepreneurs, all the legal documentation, all the call when we have to call general assemblies, we do all that. So, and also, in terms of compartments, I mean, all these compartments are fully bankruptcy remote. So there's no incidence if one of the companies should fail. Bear in mind, early stage investment is risky, okay? Also, listen what is in FAIL. FAIL stands for First Patent in Learning. We're here with like young entrepreneurs, that's why we're here with co-investors. We just have to make sure that these guys do have like enough people, enough knowledge around them just to make sure that they're, and we're not going to speak about their products, we speak about a solution. I mean, we're just making sure that what they propose is actually will have a market fit. So we just make sure there's a need for the solution that they broadcast. We do see too many projects where the guy comes at CPG. I've got a great product here, I'm probably going to outboast Facebook in a year. I say, okay, you know what? Just go back to the incubator where you come from. Just stretch your ID, just make sure there's a market fit, and then come back to us, because then you're going to really prove that you've got a real solution. Okay, you have probably heard, since you're on the platform, most of you, you've heard about the tax shelter for startups. Basically, as an individual, you are allowed to reduce your tax. Okay? It's not a tax deduction, but as a person, as a personal investor, if you invest 100,000 euros a year into one project or more, you can have 45% reduction onto your fiscal plan. And you have to do that through a crowdfunding platform or through a startup fund. So at this stage, there's like several criteria for that. But once again, the team is here to answer to all that should you need further information for that. So startups, why that? And tax shelter, why we've seen all that? Because we've seen that lately, there's like a great incentive and there's a great boost into entrepreneurships within Belgium. And so the Belgian government came with that plan to really encourage innovation and entrepreneurships. Because as a matter of fact, should it be in France or in Belgium, small companies, which are companies of less than 10%, do represent 63% of the employment rate. So once again, we are very proud to see those type of initiatives to be able to really boost the little companies that we do support. So once again, I mean, I've been speaking about that, so I'm not going to come back. When we say about young and small companies, if we speak about 45% reduction, I mean, these are the criteria that these kind of companies do have to see how to be eligible to tax shelter. Small and medium enterprises, balance sheets, it's more than 3 million, turnover it should be less than 7 million, and annual average of employees less than 50%, to be able to see 30% of tax reduction. And that's going to apply pretty soon now. It's been voted. So in July, we're going to see that coming to life. Few conditions again. So personal income tax reduction up to 45,000 per year in the same tax period of investment. Of course, you must show the proof of investment. And if you invest into tax shelter companies, we do that for you. That means that if you invest a certain amount at the end of the fiscal year, we're going to just make sure that you guys do receive a note just to attest that the investment is really tax shelterable. But you must hold the share for 48 months to be able to have that, to see that tax shelter to be valid. Otherwise, it's programs are temporary. Okay, this is how we work. I'm not going to take the floor much longer unless you've got specific questions. Has anyone got a question? Was I loud and clear? Excellent. I'm going to pass the word to Louise, who's going to introduce you to the entrepreneurs that you're going to get in tonight. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, Julie. We are going for a short presentation myself. I'm working as an investor manager at Spreads. I'm more busy. I have to say, I was very charming to meet them because they are all really behind their product. We have four presentations tonight of pitches. We always say to the entrepreneurs, keep it quite short. At Me Wet Water, we're happy to. And they are actually changing the world of advertisement as it is today, where you as a consumer are looking yourself to go towards the advertisement. So I will now give the floor to Vincent, which will explain you about his plans and then his solution for the advertising world.
Thank you. Please raise your hands now.
Yeah, fantastic.
So who among you has an app blocker installed on his computer or his code? Seems a lot, right? Next question, when confronted to a video ad popping on his screen, who, given the possibility, will skip that ad?
Sure.
Seems a lot, right, also. Next question, a bit more tricky, this time requires a little bit of honesty. Knowing that the ads are not going to disappear by magic and that you will keep seeing them, would you prefer that they be more relevant to you? They be about things that are of interest to you? If so, please raise your hands. Maybe off target then. Okay. We've established together that there are some problems with the advertising market from the point of view of the users. Now, from the point of view of the advertisers, there are also a lot of problems. And the four major ones being ad fraud, because yes, Facebook also does it. Ad blindness, because those of you who didn't raise their hand when I asked about the ad blocker, it's probably because you just don't see ads anymore. Ad blockers, if you covered that. And viewability, because the attention span of people and their tendency to skip ads means that people will just not see ads anymore. And to make matters worse, with the data protection laws coming very soon in Europe, which is a good thing for us, but a very difficult thing for advertisers, it means that it will be even more difficult to place ads that are relevant to people in front of them. So we decided to do something about it. And we created a platform that will bring together advertisers and users. And the idea is so simple, yet so efficient, that potentially everyone can be a user of our platform, and every company can become a client of our platform. It can be summed up in four easy points. And a user has to come on his own on our platform to watch ads. He decides what ad he will choose to watch. He watches it fully, and once that ad is fully watched, he has to answer a question regarding the ad he has just seen, to prove he didn't go to the toilet in the meanwhile, for example. And if he can correctly answer that question, he can instantly win the product he has just seen, or a voucher for that product. We also decided to create this platform as a safe place where the users won't have to worry about their privacy and their private information, where they can discover new products in a new way without having to be bothered when they travel around the internet and with these ads following them everywhere. And for the advertiser, we offer a platform where users will be committed to watch fully their ads, which is something that we really want. But when we created this platform, we also wanted to carry our values inside that platform. That is why we decided first and foremost for the companies that it should be important that the return on investment for every euro they spend on the platform be meaningful. Because nowadays they spend a fortune on ads because they don't know where this money is going. So, since it's a problem for them, we are going to solve that problem on our platform. but because we also have human values of our firm, and we wanted to empower these values on our platform, we decided to make that platform free of use for charity companies and for startups. We also have plans, I should have mentioned that, to allow our users to support free websites that are currently only surviving on ads. But it's coming soon, so I'm not going to delve on that. It's also a very specific platform because every advertising company will have its own page. It means that it's not just about the video ad that is played and potentially earning the product or voucher. It's also a place where people can get information like nowhere else. For example, they can find technical information regarding the product. So if one day we have a fantastic car moving around in town, you will know what kind of motor is inside and how it has been built. But it also can be practical information. Where can I buy that product? What is the price for that product? And very important to us was to allow companies to share their values. I often ask myself, do I share the values of the company? And if so, do I want to buy this product? And you can find that information on the website. And last but not least, you can also give your opinion to the brands regarding their video or their products. And you have absolutely no incentive to do so, which means that the information that you are giving them is very valuable. You are giving them so they can improve when they are ready to listen. We also made sure that our website will be very open to any size of company. So we group the ads based on the market share of each company. We make sure that every cent that they spend is on target because people will target themselves, so of course they are going to be. We take care of all the voucher distribution, which will make life very easy for small companies who don't have that in place for now. And since people can give their opinion to brands, major brands can also use what you mean to test their new content and avoid crisis when they are potentially hurting a minority and they were unaware of that before launching on major like TV or major media. And because people have to take their voucher or their free product directly from the shop, we create a very unique point of contact between the companies and the user so they can make sure that they want that product and they want to buy it in the end. So to sum it up, for the companies, we created a website that is really performance-oriented, that has engaged viewers, that can drive people directly to the points of sales or to the website, and that will create a strong conversion based on the campaign that they host on our website. And for the point of view of the users, it's a platform that that has a very strong sense for the privacy respect. We were actually GDPR compliant before GDPR were even a thing. We are a collaborative platform that will empower charity and startups. We allow people to discover products like never before, even products that they didn't know they might have an interest in, or they didn't even know that might exist. And we give a wealth of information regarding all that. After 6 months of testing, 4 months of being live, 3 months of marketing, we know that our value proposition works. People are coming to our website to watch ads, and they come back to watch more ads, and brands love our innovation. We have a clear target in mind. It's to reach 10,000 users within a year. It's the reach needed to convince the top 50 advertisers in Belgium to join us. Once that is achieved, we can go abroad as fast as possible. So, that is where you come in. We need to go abroad as fast as possible. Join us now and make this journey together. Thank you.
It's your website?
I think we have a first question over here. Is there any other questions within the public?
I had a problem.
advertising, digital marketing. And it's true that I realized that the people that I was targeting were low-cost people. So people were not ready to pay. Because Belgium really like free stuff and you see free things. And I realized it, and I had really a problem to change my target to find a bit more different customer. The thing is that my impression with watching Wix, you attract people, you attract users by saying them, hey, give us our time and you will receive a free gift or boucher or something else. You are not afraid of, again, get all those people who are not ready to pay and who just want free stuff. And then, in the end, your target is misconducted. For example, imagine you have a beautiful ad about a luxury watch. How this luxury watch can actually have different targets with people who are not ready to pay and who have plenty of time to spend on a platform.
Actually, those questions, every marketer that we've met in the last 2 years was asking that question, so it's a very good question. And we have no way to prove that it was going to work differently until we created that platform. We had that knowledge because we were asking people, and now we have the proof. So the first thing, we implemented a certain number of things to make sure that Game Hunter, they have a name, Game Hunter, they exist, who spend their day trying to win stuff, are not going to be able to empty our website. So every week, a person has a limited number of ads that they can watch on our website. So they have to make choices that are relevant to them. Because even if you are a game hunter or a promo hunter, you are going to buy some things in your life. It's inevitable. So if you watch ads that are things that interest you, you might end up buying them in there. The second thing is that, contrary to what most people think, the most beautiful gifts on our website are not those that drain the most people, because maybe they have less chances to win them, or simply because they want to win other things and they are limited in the number of things they can watch on the website. And the user base that we have currently is actually not so young and not so driven by game. They will tend to watch ads that really matters to them. So, yeah. It's very good for us. It's a very good feeling because we have achieved and proved that people will target themselves if given the opportunity. They are not just there to gain anything. But of course, I have to say, we did not advertise for our platform on Game Hunter databases and stuff like that. We really try to make our advertising as clean as possible. So it's a wide range of people. We have a little bit more women, a little bit more after 35 years old, so we really have all types of people, but the tendency is over there. Also, I should mention, below the end, you have a buy button, and people are actually using it, so we know that they are ready. And voucher use. But voucher redeem percentage is actually quite high as well. So,
this is actually related to the first question. So just to make sure, the voucher people will get once they have watched this ad, it is to buy a product from the ad they just watched, or it can be something totally different.
No, it's always and every time related to the ad, and more specifically to the product that was presented. So unless you ask the same question, if it's a brand that sells many products and that doesn't want to make one product stand up in particular, that brand can give a gift card to buy whatever they want.
Okay. And so yes, second question is, for the companies who go to your platform, for them, what is the main value? Is it to test their marketing campaign, or is it also to sell products? Do they see your platform as a selling platform as well, or rather as an advertisement platform to test their campaign?
There is no clear answer to that because every company is different. We thought a trend would emerge, but actually we have companies that are very conversion driven, so they want people to end up buying their product. We have companies that really want to test their new content on our platform, and they will probably not sell things through our advertising because it's a product that most people know. They don't need to test it to adopt it, but they would like to see if their new ads is going to be accepted by the public. So different type of companies have different objectives, and all objectives can be achieved in the channels. The only thing that we don't achieve is a kind of a mass media, because people can only watch the same ad a very limited number of times, and that is the company that decide that it's between 1 and 5. So if a person watches an ad and has a problem and cannot watch the ad anymore because the brand has decided that it will only be once, that person cannot watch the ad anymore. So you are not mass targeting people and retargeting them.
Okay, thank you everyone for your questions. I'm sure Vincent will stay a few moments afterwards as well. So whenever you have still a question for Vincent, go and grab him and give him a bit to his game. So thank you, Vincent. I will now.
Good evening, everyone. My name is William. I'm Victor. And tonight we're going to present you ParkPNP. ParkPNP is a platform and a parking app that started 40 months ago in Ireland. And tonight we are going to present you the Belgian entity and we're looking for funds for the Belgian entity. As you may know, Brussels is the third most congested city in Europe. And this is closely linked to the parking nightmare we all have. In fact, 30% of the traffic congestion is caused by drivers looking for parking spots. Those same drivers will lose on average 25 minutes a day looking for a parking spot, and the problem is getting worse. The on-street parking supply will decrease by 18% in the two following years in Brussels, while the number of cars is increasing year after year. Parking is a broken industry which has not evolved to the 21st century. As a matter of fact, we are still paying with coins while digital payments are everywhere. We are more and more talking about smart cities, but parking still has a poor brand image and has not evolved for ages. Parking is completely disconnected from the reality, and that's why we are bringing ParkPNP. ParkPNP is a parking app that allows people and businesses to find or rent underutilized parking spaces in seconds. We are the Airbnb for parking spots, but not only for private owners. We allow car park operators, hotels, churches, private owners to rent their underutilized parking spots wherever and whenever they need. ParkPNP has spent a lot of time and money developing a seamless app to provide the best parking experience ever. Through our app, you can directly find and book parking spaces in seconds, wherever and whenever you need it. You can pay seamlessly through your phone. You can enter barriers by scanning a QR code, and you can extend your booking without having to fill up park meters.
Yeah, this is the story of ParkPNP Island. In the last 40 months, ParkPNP did around 300,000 euros as a gross billing. This is around 70,000 euros as a revenue, and it represents more than 15,000 individual bookings. So yeah, 15,000 bookings, so 15,000 registered users as well. And we got more than 6,000 parking spots on the platform. Retention rate on those clients is around 8%, which is excellent. It's a really good number. And yeah, keep in mind that all of this is just in the last 14 months. So those are a few charts so you can visualize the impressive growth we've had in the last 14 months. So we had we achieved 110% in quarterly growth regarding number of parking spaces, going from 100 to more than 6,000. Regarding revenue, went from 1,000 to no more than 50,000 euros a month. So now let's talk a bit about Belgium. In the last 6 months, we gathered more than 3,000 parking spots on the platform and acquired 5,000 paying customers. We also developed a strong presence in Brussels and other major Belgian cities, and developed strong relationships and partnerships with strong Belgian brands such as Delez, BDF, Pro-National. So the last 6 months we spent a lot of time developing the platform, acquiring parking spots, developing strong relationships with our partners. And although we had great results, we knew that if we wanted to go to the next level, we had to partner with one of the future market leaders. And that's why we are bringing today ParkPNP into Belgium. Now that we have all of that, we expect our sales to go from 15k last year to 300k this year, and then to 1.5 million in 2019 and 3.2 million in 2020. So we already are present in three different countries, so obviously Belgium, then the Netherlands, and obviously Ireland. We expect to grow in the following cities in the following years to make ParkPNP the market leader in Europe. This will strengthen the Belgian position as well. This is the whole management team. So at the top you can see William and myself that will be managing the Belgian entity. And at the bottom you can see the whole management team that is centralized in Ireland. So that means that we actually have, as a Belgian entity, a full IT developer team, a full marketing team, a full sales team, for free at no cost in Belgium. Yeah, as a conclusion, I'd like to say that the parking industry still has no dominant leader, and together, today, if you invest in our company, we can make ParkPNP the leader of the parking revolution. Thank you.
Is there anyone who has a question within the public? Nobody? I'm not sure if I missed it or not, but how many users do you count today?
In Ireland we have 15,000 users, or in Belgium 5. Yeah.
Sure.
How is the Belgium entity structured? Is it like a franchising system or?
So the Belgian entity is 100% owned by the Ireland entity. We are managing the Belgian entity. That's it.
What is your differentiator compared to your concurrence, here the first company I'm thinking about is Bipark, which is present in Belgium for quite a number of years. So how do you plan to beat them?
So first of all, our old company was Streamline Park. We're on the private owner segment, so we have the Airbnb of parking spots. You can rent your driveway on our platform. And now with ParkPNP, we aggregate every parking segment. So on our platform, the supply side, we have commercial operators, hotels, churches, and private owners. So on the supply side, we really aggregate every parking segment. And then on the demand side, Bpark is mainly present on monthly bookings. They do long-term rentals. Well, we have a solution where you can book a spot in advance or on the go for half an hour to 1 month. So we differentiate ourselves on the supply side and on the demand.
surprised that it's more than, you know, normal, you would still accept it in your platform?
It really depends on which type of supply. Like if it's private owners, if they want to have a higher price, they can have a higher price. We'll just tell them, okay, if your product is not rented, we know, you know, we just told you you should lower your price. Then if it's another segment like car park operators, hotels or supermarkets, we set the price for them.
And they have the option to lower it when they see that no one is.
Yeah. They can do whatever they want with their prices. There is a whole system interface for parking owners where they can really manage all the availabilities, the prices of their parking. So potentially the anything you want with your parking.
Okay, then if there are no further questions, may I ask a big hand of applause for you. Now the next entreprise is in a completely different sector. You will discover in a minute. I had the chance to discover the entrepreneurs. So the next company is Milizia, and Milizia is specializing in luxury lingerie, and I thought only women could be very passionate and talk about lingerie with their friends, but I'm definitely wrong because I just met Pascal and Pierre, which explained me within 10 minutes this business, and they really passionately talked about the lingerie business. So I'm happy to share the same story that they will share the same story with you guys tonight. So enjoy.
Thank you all. So, I'm there to introduce tonight Milizia. I'm Pascal Lefray. I'm coming from another industry, supply chain and industry, so nothing to do with lingerie. I'm here also to tell you quite incredible story, but the true story. I stopped my job 3 years ago. I was a little bit to manage big multinationals, and I started to draw lingerie. And those drawings opened me the door of the lingerie industry. My way crossed the famous guy, which is Daniel Perret, who was also the mentor of Chantal Dumas. He created Christian Dior lingerie and Nina Ricci lingerie. And he opened me all the doors of the industry. I created my company in 2016. He was also the founder of Milizia, and in August 2016, the same year, happened something exceptional. I had the opportunity to take over the brand Milizia. Since that time, I federated around this project a lot of passionate people, talented people, with a lot of expertise, technical skills. And we launched already last year the brand quite successfully, because we reached a turnover of 600,000 euro the last part of the year, because the production process is pretty good. And today we are completely integrated, means that we are creating, we are developing our collections ourselves. So we master all the our strategy is first to launch the brand, keeping the DNA of the brand, of course, keeping the same positioning. We are in the luxury segment, so quite high margins. And we want to do that to keep the, what I call the SSCG concept, so keeping the sensual, sexy, chic, and glamorous. And we call that one letter. Someone knows? Comforting, very important. second part of our strategy is to open a new segment in sexy big cups. And we will tell you why later. So increase, let's say, the cups to a D, E, F. We need to know what's going on. And then the last part of our strategy, is to elaborate some graphs which can become visible graphs. That is part of our learning today. And then in the second stage, to open our offer is to create a small beach fair line in 2000 students. Our sales and marketing strategy. First, we want to open new sales channels with a special focus on the e-commerce platforms, because today we see the growth of quite a lot of e-commerce platforms which are quite successful. And besides that, we want to develop physical ambassadors for the brand, and we currently in the process to select multi-brand stores. Today we have around already 150 stores in the world. Spread over the world, we have some in Japan, in the US, in Russia, of course, Europe is covered as well. The second part is we have a quite high profile in digital marketing. And she will help us to develop the social media to promote the tech brand through the social media. Of course, we keep the traditional tools, press, magazines, and so on, but we need to focus on social media. And then, last but not least, we are also in the process to create an interactive B2B tool for B2B ordering. So why we are there today is, in fact, to launch the sexy deeper caps, which are very technical. Development is done. Everything is ready. We now just need to push the button on the production. But to push the button, we need to finance this production. It's around 300,000 euros. So why do we believe in our success? The number of players today with our level of expertise in qualitative deeper cups is very, very limited. We have almost 4 players only in Europe. And one of them is a Belgian company called Van de Velde. But all those players prefer to keep their category more classical. So we want to develop the more sexy, because we feel that all women wants to be sexy, not only a part. And that's why the market demand is growing very fast, also due to morphology changes over the last 15, 20 years, due to hormonal changes and so on. And so we are pretty convinced that today, if we do that, we can only grab market shares. Fort Milesia is known everywhere in the world. We have a very high recognition by professionals in the world, so we can enter the market very, very fast. The goal is very clear. It's to become a trend leader in sexy, chic lingerie. So if you are interested, not only women's but also men's, to invest in our project, I invite you to join the link and to invest, because all women can and will feel sensual with our products. So, thank you.
Very soon. So there are no specific questions right now, we can go to the next entrepreneurs. I'm sure you will say a few moments afterwards as well. So if there are any specific questions, we have one question. No. Okay. Then we go to our fourth startup we will present tonight, which is Itinahi. I think it's Nicolas who will present tonight. So Nicolas will present Itinahi, which is, if I can say so, it's something in between a traveler's blog and a traveler book, a travel guide focused on Europe. I give the floor to Nicolas.
Thank you very much. No, I don't have a question. Good evening, everybody. So I'm going to talk about Itinahi. So Itinahi is a digital travel guide, right? So it's kind of a Lonely Planet or Lambuka 2.0, right? So the kind of tool that helps travelers build their ideal trip, their customized trip, based upon shared content. So our goal is to be able to provide inspiration to travelers wherever they go, whatever they look for, and whatever the language. The focus we have is on Europe, so we try to cover the whole of Europe, and we focus on off the beaten path areas. So we don't focus on big cities or things that everybody knows, right? We try to raise content which is related to a place that people don't know a lot about, so regions, provinces in Europe that you don't know about. So how do we do that? So we have a community of editors, so more than 30 guys, so all committed young guys who are either passionate travelers, former bloggers, or locals proud of their country, of their region, of their city, and who are willing to write about it, basically, in a great way. They are all English speakers, and at the moment they have written 1,500 stories so far on the website, which are articles about things to do, events to attend, places to visit, walks to do, beaches or trips, to the bathroom, etc. So people is the core of our asset, but we are before anything else a tech startup. So we have lots of technology involved, right? And the reason why we have technology involved is that if we didn't have that, we couldn't scale. We could just do a blog with articles, and basically the number of articles would be proportional to the number of people we have, but we have technology. So we have a proprietary content too, to write articles. We have a generator of labels, so every time there is a new story which is published, basically there is an internal tool that allocates a label, either per geography or per category or per type, to the story so that people can retrieve them. We have what we call this a scraper of places. So that's an internal tool that we use to extract automatically from the web everything which is linked to something to see somewhere. So everything that we call a place. So that's a scraper, so we get lots of content, and then we can adjust the quality of the content to a human approach. At the moment, we have 100,000 places on the website across Europe. And every time there is a new story which is published, we translate it into 6 languages. Again, to a mix of technology, but not Google Translate, and some human approach for reviewing to make it great. So that's the structure that we have at the moment. So we are focusing on traction, right? It's a B2C website, so we need to have lots of users. This is what we got today, so 30K unique users, 40,000 views per month before turning multilingual. So we are right now turning multilingual. So right now, the website is being made available in 6 languages on top of English. The business model, so we are now launching a pilot phase, a B2B pilot phase. So how do we make money? We won't make money we don't want to make money through advertising, right? No, not B2C, so selling bookings and this kind of things, because the break-even point would be too far away, right? If we wanted to make money out of a commission on booking transport or booking accommodation, we would need tens of thousands of million users a month to be break-even. So the approach we have is the B2B one, and we target those businesses for which the attractiveness of the location is crucial, is core to business. So you think about hotels, chambre d'hôtes, the gîtes, but also the portals, small ones, Gîtes de Wallonie, for example, the booking, or the bigger ones. Why? Because we are going to make basically their location very attractive by proposing to them to include what we call an iframe or a widget, so that's a window that you would have on the website of the hotel, where all inspiration content would be displayed automatically without the hotel having to do anything. So for example, if you are a maison d'hôte in the Ardennes, for example, in Arnaud, right? If you have this widget, without having to do anything anymore, all the stories who would be produced by the editors who are based in the Ardennes on Knavi would appear on the website of the hotel. And what we want to prove with the look, well, what others are putting in the pilot, and what they are going to prove in the pilot as well, is that it converts better. So on top of saving time for the hotels, because they don't need to produce content anymore themselves on the website, to make it up to date, to make it multilingual, it's done automatically. On top of that, the conversion between a visitor and a customer gets higher. So that's what it's going to look like. So it's very easy to install. Huh? It's a 3 lines of code. You just have to position the hotel on the map, right? You have this widget which is there. And basically, any user who goes to the website sees all this content appearing, either articles, what we call stories, or places here. It's a carousel, so they can scroll. They can click on one on an article and it's appearing. And we want to make it as customizable as possible. So in the language of the user, and depending on what they look for. So if I'm a user who goes to the hotel website and I like sports, I'm going to see only stories about sports and places which are sports related. So this market trend that we are seeing is very recent, right? So for years, during 10 to 15 years, everybody has thoughts on bookings. So the core of the travel business sector and on the web was about transactions. So booking, transport, booking accommodation, TripAdvisor, Airbnb, etc. And now we are seeing more and more focus on content. So proprietary authentic content. We have seen Skyscanner acquiring trips 6 months ago. We are seeing companies like Abuxi making a deal with Kayak, because Kayak is a huge business search engine where you can book flights and places, right? So it's a big engine. And what they are trying to do with Abuxi is to add for each hotel a small window with this is what you can do around this hotel, because they have measured the conversion is higher when you know what you can do around the hotel when deciding to book. Well, I'm not going to enter into the details. So it's a B2C approach with a recurring monthly fee, right? So you pay 30 euros per month after the pilot phase. The pilot phase is going to last for the next 6 months. It's going to be free for the hotels, because we are going to improve the product so that was to make it ready. And then we are going to spread it. The next milestones are to finalize the turning into the full multilingual, to launch the B2B pilots. Extend the coverage throughout Europe. So at the moment we have 30 countries covered. So we want to go towards 40 in Europe. And include additional user-centric features to get into a real comprehensive travel planner, right? So not just inspirational. This is the team, so a big part of it is there with us. So it's a mix of technical skills and more, I would say, HR or communication related. I am myself a former nuclear engineer, so we're going to do the job. I am a technical guy from the beginning. Leon is the CTO. Madi, she takes care of hiring, selecting, and managing the community of editors, making sure that the content is great and that is SEO proof. So we need content that is great for Google as well to be indexed properly. Roxanne is taking care of content development. Lydia just joined us for design, and Manon takes care of the communication. And then Leon is the CTO, and he's recording he was 8. Voilà. Thank you very much.
Is there anyone who has a question before?
I just wanted to ask if the platform is open to everyone, or you have to first create a profile in order to browse through the different hotels, information, etc., or it's free?
No, it's open to anyone.
Okay, so you don't need to create a profile.
Yeah, anybody can access the platform and see the content. It's only for some features and more advanced, like sharing or liking articles, or saving them in your what we call backpack, right? So that you are able to treat them, then you would need to log in, but you can log in to Facebook or to your Google account as well, or to email address. But it's open to anybody. Yeah.
Well, and also for the country or it's like they do it for free because it's just fun to write about those places where
that's the choice that we have to make. It's an investment that we make. We pay the editors, so we did some benchmark, right?
Yeah.
But we pay the editor per article, so that we make sure of the quality of the content that is produced. We don't want to open it to any kind of social network of travelers. So we want to have a great content and a structured approach, so as to make sure we have good coverage.
Okay, great. I have one more question. For who was it the first time tonight to assist one of our online offline? I see a few faces who came here for the first time. So thank you for being here tonight. Thank you for listening to the entrepreneurs. We now invite you all to have a beer with us and enjoy our terrace. The entrepreneurs are staying a bit as well, so take the time to ask them some useful questions, or if you have questions about our platform. And then I want to say you're doing this event on a monthly basis. Often it's the first Tuesday of the month, and we're open for everyone so that you can meet the entrepreneurs in real life, as most of the time you can only scroll through the profile, so this is really the opportunity to meet those entrepreneurs. So thank you all, and you're welcome to have another class.